Ken Blase. During the next half hour, we'll take a close look at this historic landmark. And we'll get better acquainted with Sarah Winchester and this fascinating house she designed. The Winchester Mystery House is a sprawling mansion in San Jose, California, that combines the grandeur of Victorian architecture and the mystery of the woman who built it. The plaque outside the house, declaring it California State Historic Landmark, number 868, reads, "Built by Sarah Winchester, widow of rifle manufacturer William Winchester. This unique structure includes many outstanding elements of Victorian architecture and fine craftsmanship. Construction began in 1884 and continued without interruption until Mrs. Winchester's death in 1922. The continual building and remodeling created a 160-room house covering an area of 6 acres. This only begins to tell the strange story that surrounds this house and its architect. Sarah Winchester was 46 years old when she arrived in the Santa Clara Valley from New Haven, Connecticut. The area she came to was quite different from the Silicon Valley we see today. San Jose, the valley's major city, was a bustling center of agricultural and business activity. Downtown was recognized by its huge light tower built in 1881. But mostly, the valley was dominated by open space and orchards. Born Sarah Pardee, she was a small woman, apparently no more than 4'10" tall. She was well-educated, speaking 4 languages. She was well-schooled in music. In 1862, during the Civil War, she married William Wirt Winchester, the son of the inventor of the Winchester repeating rifle. The death of their infant daughter, Annie Pardee, caused Sarah great grief, as did her husband's death of tuberculosis 15 years later. There are stories that Sarah was so upset by the deaths of her daughter and husband that she visited a spiritual medium in Boston who told her to go west and begin building night and day. By doing this, she would be able to achieve eternal life and appease the spirits of all of those killed by the Winchester rifle, better known as the gun that won the West. Another theory is that related by her coachman who accompanied her here from New Haven, who said that she was so upset by the death of her husband that her doctor prescribed a change to a milder climate and a vigorous hobby that would help her overcome her deep-seated grief. In June 1886, she bought an 8-room farmhouse from a John Hamm for $12,570 in gold coin, along with some adjacent property, and began building. She was absorbed in the remodeling. And in only 6 months, the 8-room farmhouse had grown to a 26-room house. Yanata Villa, the name she gave the house, became a self-contained village with its own electric generating plants and water supply, water drain and sewage systems. She had no master plan for the house and seemed to build whenever, wherever, and howsoever she pleased. It was this strange and extravagant hobby that would furnish an outlet for her energies for over 36 years and prompted gossip from her neighbors. It's been reported that Sarah, who had no previous known architectural experience, would sketch her ideas on scraps of paper and then have them executed by 6 or 7 carpenters, painters, tile setters, and other workmen as needed. She paid her workmen well, and they remained loyal to her over the years. She bought the most expensive lumber and invested in beautiful stained glass and other ornaments throughout the years. So it appears that Sarah spent several comparatively happy years puttering around her prune orchards and planning new rooms, tearing off outside walls and roofs time and again to build farther and higher. Sarah's lack of experience, or perhaps the fact that she continually added on to sections without tearing them down, resulted in what appear to be building errors. So with this background, let's move inside the Winchester house. Here we find doors opening into walls, staircases that lead to the ceiling, shingles inside the mansion, bathroom doors with glass in them, posts that never reach the ceiling, cabinets that open on rooms, and a cabinet only 1 inch deep. When she made mistakes or changed her mind, she blithely demolished and started over. Hid mistakes with drapes, built right over them. or simply left them undisguised. So as the house continued to expand, rumors began to circulate in the area about the Winchester house and the woman who lived there. By 1900, it's estimated that 90 rooms had been built, rebuilt, or changed in some way, and the house had reached a height of 7 stories. The San Francisco earthquake in 1906 caused substantial damage to the house, as well as many other buildings in the San Jose area. Some stories place Sarah trapped in this upstairs bedroom, known as the Daisy bedroom, because of the exquisite stained glass windows. Others claim she wasn't at home at all. Whichever's correct, it is known that she stopped work on the front third of the house, essentially closing it off. The top two floors, including the tower, were badly damaged in the quake and were never rebuilt. After the earthquake, she spent an undetermined amount of time in this houseboat in Burlingame. When she returned, she decided it was safer to build out than up. Apparently, she talked of wrecking the place because it looked as though it was built by a crazy person. She was persuaded instead to have the unsafe portions pulled off or boarded up.
We're privileged to have with us Minnie Yeager Hall. And Minnie, I understand that you really know the Winchester Mystery House and, in fact, knew Mrs. Winchester. When did you first come into contact with this famous house and with Mrs. Winchester?
Well, it started when the year before I started grammar school. And 1910 is when I actually started to know the Winchester place. I didn't know Mrs. Winchester at that time. I first met the Hansons, and they had two little boys, a year and 2 years younger than I. And we were the only children within quite a radius here, so we became very, very close friends.
Who were the Hansons?
Mr. Hanson was the caretaker. He was the overseer of the place.
And did the Hansons live on this estate?
Yes, they did. They lived just back of where the carriage entrance is where their living quarters was.
When do you first remember seeing or meeting Mrs. Winchester?
Well, I saw her mainly when I met her, when we talked, was when she would come for her afternoon walk. I had to be home at 4 o'clock from my playing over here, and so I would go home at 4 o'clock. So I'd always stop and say hello and have my childish chatter, and she'd ask me about school, and she was just as plain and just as sweet as any grandmother could be. And I just learned to know her, and they learned to know me as Little Minnie. So I remained Little Minnie as long as they were here together. And after Mrs. Winchester passed away, I always kept in touch with her secretary, and my letters were always addressed to Little Minnie.
Were you ever in the house?
Yes, Mr. Hanson took the boys and I through, as I recall, about 3 or 4 times, but we were right at his heels. And he pointed out beautiful things to us that had been done. I was simply fascinated with the floor in the ballroom. I never forgot that. It was just something that I dreamed about.
Minnie had sometimes said that after the earthquake in 1906, when the front of this house was damaged, that Mrs. Winchester stopped construction, considered that to be some sort of warning. What's your feeling about that?
I don't believe it. Henrietta, her secretary, told me later, when I was grown, and we had several conversations about these things that I heard that I didn't like, and she didn't like either, of course. Why do these stories come out? And she said, well, after the earthquake, Mrs. Winchester decided to make this a hobby house. And she just liked to build these things to see what they looked like in certain wood. She paid her carpenters twice as much as other carpenters got.
Before we leave the front one-third of the house, let's take a closer look at the great beauty and the type of furnishing found in these front rooms that were boarded up because of the earthquake. I'm standing here in the restored front entry hall, with its elaborate inlaid floors, West African mahogany woodwork, and Lincresta wall coverings. We're seeing the finest the Victorian era had to offer. Experts have said that the mansion contains one of the finest and largest collections of art glass doors and windows in the world. The enormous storehouse of materials left behind at Sarah's death include other Tiffany-style glass and ornate gold and silver fixtures, which maintain a sparkling vigil to this day. Throughout the house, valuable windows, now restored, give a hint of the beauty found in the house. This is Sarah's grand ballroom. It was damaged in the earthquake, but now has been restored. It's a vision of meticulous craftsmanship. Originally, a full year went into laying the parquet floor with its seven woods. Two windows in the room hold puzzling Shakespearean messages. From Troilus and Cressida, wide unclasp the tables of their thoughts. And from Richard II, and these same thoughts people this little world. What meaning Mrs. Winchester had in mind is still unknown. In addition to the beautiful woods found in the many inlaid floors throughout the house has 47 fireplaces. All were hand-carved on the premises, and no two are alike. In the so-called Hall of Fires, we find seven sources of heat. Four fireplaces, and three forced air registers. During wintertime, Mrs. Winchester, who suffered from painful arthritis, would close herself in the room and turn up the heat for pain-relieving warmth. Victorian designs lead to all types of appurtenances, including balconies, turrets, towers, curved walls, porches, cornices, and a wide variety of windows, elaborately turned posts, paneling, arches, wooden balls, trellises, cupolas, ornamental chimney stacks, and the list goes on. This beautiful window, priced at $1,500 at the turn of the century, is set into a wall next to a stairway that connects two floors. The window is made of art prisms designed to turn ordinary sunlight into multiple rainbows. But a room was added behind the wall, and the window was placed where no direct sunlight would ever hit it, so its real beauty is not seen. These easy risers replaced some of the original stairs, making it easier for her to get around as her arthritis worsened. The servants' call box and intercom made it possible for Sarah to locate her servants, and for the servants to easily locate Sarah. And her sunroom was designed so that her plants could receive both sunlight and water. When the servants watered the plants, they would first raise the floorboards, exposing a zinc subfloor. The water would collect on the metal floor and then be drained to water the garden below. In addition, the Winchester house contains 52 skylights and more than 10,000 windows. In some instances, skylights were built directly atop each other, one such to the height of four stories. The extensive network of windows and skylights and shafts offered the advantage of sunlight throughout the house. Even the smallest room is likely to have a window for light. This is Sarah's so-called séance room. If one believes the legend, Sarah took very seriously the need to work with spirits in the building of the house. According to this version, she communicated with the spirits who governed her life and would hold nightly seances. Refuting this idea is John Hansen, foreman of the property for many years. He said that the seance room was used by him as a bedroom for 8 months, and then by the caretaker, a Japanese cook and his wife, a nurse, and the chauffeur. There are rumors of Mrs. Winchester holding seances in the ballroom and dancing with the spirits. When did you
first hear of those rumors, and what was your reaction to them?
When this became commercial, I don't remember ever hearing of any of that before. But after this did come up, and at the visit that I was with her secretary down south after she had married and established her home there, my husband and I visited her, and she and I had just a little time together when there were some of these things that I put to her, and that was one of them. I said, is there any truth to this fact that Mrs. Winchester had spirits and was guided by the spirits and so on? She said, no, that was not true.
You said that Henrietta referred to this as her hobby house. Did she live in the house during that time when it was?
No, Mrs. Winchester never lived in this house during these years that I've told you about. Her home was in Atherton, and she would come down maybe once during a week. Maybe she wouldn't be down for 2 weeks. I mean, she would just come down for a visit, so to speak, and she would stay a few days and maybe a day. We children were always told when Mrs. Winchester was here and that we should go and play on the other side of the yard. And she did not live in this as her home. It always was just a place to come to enjoy her hobby.
Minnie, how would you characterize Mrs. Winchester?
She was the nicest, kindest, most generous lady I have ever had cross my pathway.
Interesting.
I loved her. And everyone I ever knew that worked for her loved her. To give you an idea of what kind of a lady she was, there was one time that Mr. Hansen had to be away for an overnight, and he asked my father if he would come over and milk a cow. My dad was glad to do it. And when he came over, Mrs. Winchester and Henrietta came out, and Mrs. Winchester asked my dad if he would mind if she would come and watch him. And he said, no, he'd like to have her. So they came down with my dad and to the barn, and she sat on her little chair there with Dad, watched him milk the cow, and talked, and was just, he said, as friendly as, and just as plain as anybody could be. And he enjoyed the experience, and she thanked him very graciously when he went home. And then about 2 days after that, her gardener, Tommy, came over with a wheelbarrow with two imported, very lovely trees that he planted on our home place there, and he always cherished. But that would just show you the humility, the kind of a lady she was.
Not only was this rambling house of interest to the neighbors, but the garden sparked curiosity too. Sarah was an enthusiastic gardener, and with her full-time staff of 8 gardeners, she introduced plants, herbs, flowers, and shrubs from over 110 countries. Today, we still find 100-year-old rose bushes, ferns, feather and fan date palms, and trees from around the globe. Among the rare plants, Sarah also planted her favorite, the daisy. Daisy designs are also found in the house, in windows, woodwork, and elsewhere.
This tree right in front of us, it's all in bloom. On my father's birthday, which was in April, my mother always used to have me come over and ask Tommy for a bouquet for my dad. And that tree was one of the ones that I always wished would bloom in April so that I could have some of that for that bouquet. And I'm also appreciating that deer that's there.
As Minnie Hall pointed out, Mrs. Winchester was a generous woman. She anonymously contributed money to many charities. In fact, she was named Honorary Director of Associated Charities, established in 1894 in Santa Clara County. In 1911, she established the William Wirt Winchester Memorial Sanatorium for Tuberculosis in New Haven with an endowment of $1.2 million. During World War I, she bought thousands of dollars worth of Liberty Bonds in support of the war effort. When Sarah Winchester died on September 5th, 1922, her doctor, Dr. Clyde Wayland, claimed that he never found her eccentric in any way,
and that her mind seemed keen to the very end. Sarah's house and property, into which she had by now invested $5.5 million, was sold in November 1922 to a T.C. Barnett. It was sold again in 1923 to a Mr. A.P. Marsden, and then again in October 1932 to Mr. John H. Brown. The surrounding orchards were sold, and the house was opened to the public in 1923 as a curiosity, with emphasis placed on the legends surrounding Sarah and her house. Minnie, what do you think Sarah's reaction would have been to all of these stories?
I don't think that they are hurting Sarah wherever she is. I don't think she would mind. I think she'd sort of enjoy them. To me, she was the kind of a person that lived the best she knew how to live, and I think that if she figured somebody was enjoying something, I think she'd enjoy having them enjoy it. I just feel that way about her.
For a number of years, the house and garden were not tended and gave the house a haunted and abandoned look. The rambling Victorian began its slow decay. The elegant garden sprouted weeds, the lawn went to seed, and then the flowers died. Between the earthquake damage and vandalism, the expensive imported wallpaper was chipped and peeled, and the windows were shattered. Sarah Winchester's mansion at the end of the lane, bordered by the 13 stately palm trees, became synonymous with haunted houses, and the widow herself was more than associated with the rumors that had plagued her during her lifetime. Keith Kittle is a general manager of the Winchester Mystery House, and he's been here since about 1974. And Keith, I guess you've seen most of or a great deal of the restoration that's taken place here.
I actually started with them in 74, about 8-9 months after the restoration began.
How long have we had tours through this house in its original state?
Ken, the tours started back in 1923, and they've continued almost daily since that point. Christmas Day is the only time tours aren't offered.
From 1923 to 1970s, what prompted all that time to pass before restoration, or what prompted you to restore the house at, in the 70s?
I think probably the impetus behind the restoration came with two factors, the coming of the nation's bicentennial in 1976, and also to have it prepared and restored when San Jose celebrated its bicentennial in 1977.
How far along was the restoration at that time?
The original restoration, which started in 73, was intended to last 2 to 3 years. But little did they know that it would take 10 to 11 years, and there's still restoration going on today. Most of the restoration has been completed, but there's still a great deal more to do.
What's been accomplished in the restoration? What was done to the house?
There were several areas that they touched on. The first, of course, was to restore the house itself, and to get the house back in the same condition that it was in when Sarah lived here. That entailed interior and exterior. Interior, getting furniture back into the rooms. Today, about 24 rooms are furnished and refurbished. Refinishing the outside, redoing the wooden shingles, replacing wooden gutters, the finials that you see on the tops of the roofs, replacing huge sections of the roof itself. Another section of the restoration had to do with getting the gardens back into the shape that they were in then, replanting most of the trees and shrubs that had been allowed to die off over those years, getting the high hedges back in, the boxwood hedges, and a lot of the plants and flowers that were here when Sarah walked through the gardens.
The hedges in the gardens and that sort of restoration, was that working from photographs or from recollections?
Well, mostly from photographs. There are a lot of old glass plate, 8x10 glass plate photos that we have that date around the turn of the century. And that's where some of the gardens, and a lot of the gardens have just had to be restored from booklets on what Victorian gardens might have looked like at the turn of the century.
160 rooms in the house. If one were to visit, how many rooms do we likely see?
You see, the tours actually go through or see approximately two-thirds of the rooms in the house. About a third are not seen on the tour. In most cases, they're unfinished and wouldn't be safe to walk through because of no flooring or no wall materials.
How do you respond to criticism that, or suggestion that maybe some of the mystery surrounding the Winchester Mystery House is fabricated, that maybe she wasn't a spiritualist or conducting seances and so forth?
Ken, I think you've heard stories throughout our lifetime, and stories started back at the turn of the century. My own grandmother had visited the house with a Dr. Curtis back in 1915. And she reported at that time that Sarah did, when she visited as the aide to the dentist that worked on Mrs. Winchester's teeth, that Mrs. Winchester did indeed wear a veil. And my grandmother was warned by some of her classmates at San Jose Normal School that she might not come back alive if she visited the house. That's another side of the story that you don't read.
So the story is that the story or the history of the house really is a compilation of many reports from many observers.
From people that lived here, people that were in the home, to the news reports. Most of the story we tell today has been compiled from all the news reports and the stories that they were able to get their hands on starting back in about 1924. And we try to present all of the sides of the story that we know. I don't suppose we'll ever know the entire story of why Sarah Winchester built the way she did.
Where do most of the visitors come from who tour the house?
Ken, that's interesting. You would think they might be local people, but in fact, the bulk of the tourists that visit here are from out of state. About a third come from Southern California. Today, about 3 to 4% of our visitors are from foreign countries, and that's a number that's increasing every year.
How do you promote this out of state? I mean, how do people know about it when they come to the Bay Area?
Probably the greatest way people learn about the house would be through the press materials that have been written by the media. Television stories, John Davidson, that's incredible, to tell the truth. I think seances that have been held that have been publicized throughout the country. But many of the journalists, newspaper and magazine reports that have been written year in and year out.
Keith, congratulations on your work in the restoration of this house. And I'm sure Sarah Winchester would be pleased to know that the restoration is going on and the work still continues on the Winchester Mystery House.
We haven't been able to show you all of the rooms or relate all of the tales surrounding this house, but we're sure you'll agree that it's an interesting example of Victorian architecture. And we're sure you'll agree that its architect was an interesting woman. Whether Sarah Winchester was guided by the advice of spirits in the building of this house, or whether she just enjoyed building as a hobby, we'll never know. The mystery of the Winchester House continues. Thank you.